well, it certainly adds an element of authenticity
to the film. And since we never considered doing it anywhere else, I'm not sure I can quite imagine or visualise what it would have been like. It was entertaining to see the look on all the residents' face, many of whom were there when all this happened, when the van drove down the crescent again. I think I had mixed feelings about that. And it was also very entertaining to talk to them about Miss Shepherd and about Alan. You could have made a kind of Rashomon movie about the various different versions they had of her, although on the essentials they were all in agreement.
It was amazing to be sitting at his desk in his window with the van back in the driveway. Immense help with your imagination.
Well, I don't live there. If I'd lived there, it would have been a nightmare. But I've never had a film crew in any place I've lived, because with the best will in the world, they always cause chaos. But I didn't live there. Anthony Crawler, the photographer, lives there, it's different from when I lived there anyway. So I didn't have any sort of pangs about it, and I was very glad. If we hadn't had the house, I don't suppose we'd have been able to make the film. So it's a very good thing we did.
Well, they were in luxury. They were actually in a real house. The van wasn't the most comfortable place, but it was where I spent most of the time, I must admit. But they were all in comfort. So figures, doesn't it?
Lost Crescent's kind of a unique street, really, in Camden. Obviously, Alan knows far more than I do, but it's kind of sandwiched between, you know, Regent's Park and the railway line and the kind of ever-moving stream of urban activity that is Camden High Street and Market. So it's this little oasis, really, and when Alan lived there, and indeed now, it seems to be inhabited by quite creative, liberal-minded, you know, quite well-off, but kindly people, and therefore they tolerated Miss Shepherd for many years, and they tolerated us, I'm happy to say.
Method, were you?
Method?
Yeah, method.
Right. Not a lot of that is required if you are dressed as I was and in a van. I mean, that was method enough. I really didn't go in, you mean into the inner whatnot?
Yeah.
No, I didn't dare do that. I just kept thinking about her.
How was it revisiting the part after 15 years since
you
did it on stage?
It was very, very different. Very different, because on stage it was much, much broader and... But the film was much more concentrated, you know. It was a whole different thing.
Well, they were both physically demanding, weren't they? I mean, the stage as well.
The stage was more demanding because, But that, no, and it was a long time ago and I could handle it. But it just wasn't very easy, the being constricted by the van. But I did go out and about, though. I just wasn't in a house very often. I'm just going to say, it's extraordinary. This happened to one person. There seemed to be thousands and thousands and thousands of people who are looking for somewhere to live. This is just one single person. And I don't know whether today it would happen. I really don't. I don't think it would happen to you again, would it?
I hope not.
No.
But I don't think compassion isn't the right word. I mean, I'm always having to say this. It wasn't compassion in quite that way. If somebody had said to me, if you let her into the garden, she's going to be there for 15 years. I would never have had her in there, obviously. But the reason why she came into the garden was because I could see her from where I worked was, say, at this table, and when she was parked in the street, she would be about the second row of the audience. And so I could see everything that happened. And people did used to rough her up, and kids used to persecute her, and people in the market did. And you always had to have one eye on the lookout for anything happening to her. Now, I was trying to work, and you can't work like that. And in the end, it was simply a case of self-preservation, from my point of view, that she came in because I wanted to get on with my work, and if she was in the garden, she'd be out of the way. So it's the reverse of compassion from my point of view.
Your respective ages are a matter of record, and yet your energy level is enormous. How do you keep that up? Is it diet? Is it attitude? Is it some secret? Or just give me some hope.
How do you keep it up?
I think the only thing that makes me look not look my age is my hair. Otherwise, you know, I feel every minute of my 81 years.
All that work you've had.
What?
All that work you've had.
It's a blessing to be able to go on working. I mean, and to also, for both of us, for the public still has an appetite for what we do. Playwrights particularly have a quite a short life. That they often have a vogue, and then they go out. You know, people go off them, and that's it. And I'm very lucky in that people still want to read the stuff I write. And I suppose Maggie see the stuff that you do.
I'm very lucky because there's always this endless thing about there aren't any parts for women over a certain age. Well, I've kind of reached the limit now because I'm sure there aren't many after the age I am. But I think they're talking about a middle age. But I don't know what the energy thing is. The energy comes from the people who are around you and one's director. And a lot of energy came from Nick to get us through. But it is tough, and I can't say it's easy at the age I am. I'm not speaking for you because you're okay. he's always on a bicycle and things, you know.
Well, I used to watch you and think, well, I couldn't do that. And, you were doing stuff that I would never have been able to do.
Yeah, I'm not sure I could do it anymore.
Well. On a Monday morning, the van was parked outside the house through the weekend. And you know Camden Town is party central on Saturday, and it turned out through Sunday night. When they turned up first thing Monday morning to reopen the van, they found a couple of people who'd been who'd been having a good time with each other and with whatever substances they'd in the van. They'd apparently been there all weekend, and when I arrived, when I arrived a little later, they were evacuating the van of all its filthy contents, which were obviously just kind of fake filthy. They were art department filthy, to have them deep cleaned because they had no idea what these two youngsters who were flat out in the back of the van had been doing through the weekend. And they all had to get deep cleaned and then made filthy again. And I had to keep from Maggie why we suddenly were swapping the schedule for the whole day round, because I never dared say that you'll now be occupying a van that has been occupied by two people who have been indulging in various activities, legal and illegal, right through the weekend. So that's a...
No, I was told much later. Cowards. <anyway. laughs>
She was, as a person, she was unreachable. So the fact, if I'd known that she'd been a very good pianist, for instance, or she'd studied with Corto, as I found out after she died, I couldn't have talked to her about that because she just wouldn't, it wouldn't come back, you know. She'd say, I don't want to know, or she would just shut up shop and stop talking. So in that sense, she remained unreachable, I think. It made her seem, and I think I say this, I said this in the original book, after she died and I found out about her, it made her life seem much more adventurous and much more eventful than my own, really, which would have pleased her no end, I'm quite sure. But I don't think my attitude to her has changed. People tend to think of her as being a sweet, sweet old lady. She was not that, and she wouldn't have survived had she been, you know, a much more kindly person.
I played him in two short pieces that Alan wrote. One was a kind of concert piece that he wrote with the Medici String Quartet about his sort of musical memories of going to concerts and churches growing up in Leeds, and the String Quartet wanted to revive it 4 or 5 years ago. Alan didn't want to do it again and suggested that I do it. So that was the first time that I kind of dusted off my Alan Bennett, you know, which many of us kind of do around the kitchen. And then he wrote a play to accompany that that happened at the National Cocktail Sticks, which was about Alan and his parents, and came to all the rehearsals. And so I had, you know, that I had Alan to sort of watch and be told what to do by. And he always wanted me, Alan wants me to be tougher than I perhaps sometimes was. And I also, for the movie, had to kind of butch up because he has shoulders and I don't. So they had to kind of make me wider to be Alan Bennett. And you watch and listen, and a lot of the clues are in the words and the rhythm of his writing.
In your real life, for who you're closer, to Lady Violet Crowley or to Miss Shepherd?
Which one I'm close to? I'm not very close to either. I think curiously, I feel easier with the lady in the van than with that lady with the hat on. It was much easier to, I can only talk as an actress, it was much easier to be Miss Shepherd, because she didn't mind how she looked, and it was such a relief, because Lady Violet was forever in those corsets and things that Miss Shepherd would never have dreamed of going there. So for comfort alone, it was nicer to be Miss Shepherd. That's as much of your question as I managed to hear.
The first replacement van was a gift from somebody called Lady Wiggin, who was... Miss Shepherd was Catholic, very Catholic, and Lady Wiggin was Catholic, and I think it was somehow that connection which commended Miss Shepherd to her. And she lived round the corner in Regent's Park Terrace, and she occurs in the film rather slightly libelously, but she because Lady Wiggin was very sympathetic to Miss Shepherd, whereas Lady Wiggin in the film is rather keeps her at arm's length. But she gave Miss Shepherd the van, but I did say to her, well, couldn't the man be left outside your house? And she said, oh, no. And Regent's Park Terrace is rather grander than Gloucester Crescent. So that was the first van. The second van, I don't know how she didn't really have any expenses. She didn't have any rent to pay. I ran electric out from the house, but she didn't have any bills. And she had an address, which means that she'd get a certain more social security. So she actually had some money. When she died, she had £6,000 in a building society. So she would be able to afford a van. But I never asked her that. And it wasn't simply a van. It was that she also then bought a rather Only Fools and Horses type three-wheeler. What are they called?
Reliant.
Reliant, yeah.
Robin Reliant.
Yeah. She didn't care about money, and money was never a problem. And to the extent that when she died, and I had to go through the van, there was about £600 trodden into all the muck and filth on the floor of the van.
So. Did you meet Miss Shepherd?
I first visited to talk to Alan about the first thing we did together about a few months after Miss Shepherd died. I used to walk past a lot because I always lived in that area, and I used to try and work out who lived where. And I did know Alan lived at 23, and I had no idea what the van and the old lady were about. I do remember thinking once, does he keep his mother in a van? I mean, I dismissed that thought. But when I went, finally, to talk about The Wind in the Willows, which Alan was going to adapt and I was going to direct as a children's show, Christmas show at the National Theatre back in 1990. So it must have been a matter of months after Miss Shepherd died. And I didn't ask what was that van that was there all those years, because you don't. You're English, you're polite. And then when finally I found out about it the same time as everybody else did, when Alan first published his diary about her in the London Review of Books, and discovered that even when the van was in the drive, Alan writes that people used to visit him and were too polite to say, what is that van and who is that old lady who are in your drive? So I was no different from anybody else.
What does home mean to me?
Yeah.
I'm so glad I've got one. It means having had a practice at not having one. It means an awful lot. I don't know where. There is no way you could live in a van. I don't think. I know people do. Some people live in cars, but surely not for that length of time. I've lived in my home for a very long time, and I dread to think what it would be like without it. It means everything.
Obviously, one is very lucky. I see parallels between Miss Shepherd and our own household, in the sense that both my partner and I accumulate stuff, and it's not in the least bit chaotic like the van was. But nevertheless, Miss Shepherd used to accumulate stuff, and which she didn't use, and this was no different in a way from a normal person, from a person leading a normal life. For instance, one of the things in the van after she died was one of those panels on which her brushes and kitchen implements and so on, which are meant for display in a kitchen. And I remember my mother having one, and we never using the actual implements on this And similarly, it was with Miss Shepherd. She brought this. There was no way she would be using the brushes and the various kitchen implements, the life she led, but she somehow saw herself as leading that kind of life, or maybe leading that kind of life one day. So, in a sense, she was not so remote from ordinary life as one thinks.
Well, I don't know that this is the theme of the film at all, but three of my grandparents were what would now be called, with a cold lip, migrants. Home for me is underpinned by the knowledge that it could all have been incredibly different. I feel very lucky.